Hello everybody, I'm Nick, and in this video you're going to see how you can properly run migrations in .NET without falling into the trap that basically every developer doing this is falling into. You're going to learn it how proper companies do it in production, because if, for example, you have migrations in the startup of your application and you ensure created any of that, that's wrong. You should never do it. You're going to fall into some very, very nasty issues. And in this video, you're going to see how to do it for production. Now, this video is not by me. This video is from my good friend and Dome Train author, Guy Ferreira, and he's going to show you how to do this properly. Now, Guy has a YouTube channel as well, and quite frankly, he makes way better videos than I do. So click that link in the description if you like what you see in this video and subscribe to his channel. I think the way Guy explains things both in code and video is amazing. So Guy, take it away.
Thanks, Nick. In fact, there's many things that can go wrong when you run the migrations on the startup of your application. But before we go there, let me tell you that there's still a place to run that ensure created database on the startup of an application. As an example, are you running a simple demo application? Is it just for development when you are starting your application on your own machine? Is it for the sake of your integration tests? Or if we want to talk about the production scenario, if you are deploying an application on a mobile device, eventually that is exactly what you are looking for. However, if you are deploying your application on a server, that can go wrong. And it all starts once you need to scale out your application. Once you have your application on a server and you scale out that server, things like concurrency, deadlocks, data corruption, those things start happening. But the problems with that approach don't stop there. Why? Because for something like this to be possible, for something like let's run a database script, a migration script, let's create tables, let's add columns, let's delete tables, those types of things require a given level of permissions. Okay, you need to have an high permission level inside of your database. So that means that your application will be running with a connection string that has a lot of privileges. And that is something that you want to avoid. You want your applications running with a user, a database user, that has a restrict level of permissions just to do the things that the application needs. If the application needs to insert some data, needs to delete some data, needs to update data, that's exactly what that connection string should allow you to do. So your application shouldn't be capable of modifying a given table. Otherwise, things like SQL injection can lead to destroying your database. Someone can run a drop table and you know what will happen. So the question is, what should we do instead? The secret is to start thinking about deployment of migrations, of database migrations, as a release step. It's not a starting step. It's not an initialization of the application step. It's a precondition to deploy that version of that application. And where do we define those types of preconditions? On something like our release pipeline. So let's see how to put something like that in practice. So on a recent video, Nick showed you this source code. And he told you that you shouldn't run this thing, the ensure created async or ensure created for your database on a production environment. Why? Because of all of those problems that we mentioned before. So our first step here will be to think if we want to extract this thing out of this program.cs, even deleting that source code, or if we want to keep it there. So the answer on this case can be something as simple as, okay, let's keep this thing, but just for development. So when my team is using this code, doesn't need to run a given script, doesn't need to go to a given database, open a connection, run a SQL script. They don't need to do anything like that. So it will happen naturally. That means that we can do something as simple as having an if statement. And then we can quickly do something as simple as application.environment.isDevelopment. This way, I know that all the source code that is here will only run for our development environment. With that in place, we can still run the application locally, and we can see that once we start the application, it will execute the migrations, and we can see all the things here. we have the create table, and we have the seeding running. So if I call that API, so if we do a get to our movies API, we can see that we have the data. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So we can see that we can get data from the database. But how will this happen on a production environment? If I can't run this on my production environment, what should I do instead? So for that, we can use some tooling that we have access to that is part of Entity Framework. For what we are going to do, you need to have installed the .NET EF .NET Entity Framework tool on your command line. So if you run the command .NET EF, you can see that I have the Entity Framework core .NET command line tools for version 9. How do you install it? Quite simple. Once you have the .NET CLI, you just run the .NET tool install .NET EF. With that, you will have access exactly to what I will be using here. So those tools give you access to do several types of things. For example, adding a new migration to your source code. But the thing that you'll be doing is to extract, based on the migrations of Entity Framework, something that we can execute as part of our pipeline. And one of the ways of doing it is by running the command .NET EF migrations bundle. That command will need the reference to the project where the .NET EF tool can find the migrations. So you will provide the argument project with a path to the CS proj. Also, you can output the EF bundle. What this command will do is that it will basically generate an executable that can perform the migrations. So it's kind of like looking into your source code, understanding the migrations that are inside of that project, and extracting a lightweight version of the source code that is just concerned about migrations and database initialization. Once you have that, that means that you can run this thing as part of your pipeline. So if we run the ls, you can see that now I have an EF bundle here. So that is the executable. However, it's something that I don't want to commit in my project, okay? I want my pipeline to be the responsible to do that, to generate that EF bundle. So I will remove the file. And now let's focus on having a pipeline that will perform the steps needed before deploying the source code. And now we are going to do that. We'll be using GitHub Actions and deploying this API to a web application on Azure, an app service, and we'll perform the migrations on the Postgres database running on Azure. So our first step will be to introduce our GitHub action. So I will bring a new file, and GitHub actions should live under a .github workflows folder that should be on the root of your repo. There, we can add our YAML file that will be the GitHub action. And the baseline of our GitHub action can be something as simple as this, okay? We'll have the job deploy that will run on Ubuntu. We check out the code. We set up .NET installing version 9. And then we do the restore of the dependencies and run the build, okay? We'll have here steps to run tests and things like that. We don't have that in place, but it's always a good idea. Once we have that, we can run the deploy to our Azure web app. For that, I will be using a publish profile that I will add as a secret into my repo. And what we'll do next is that we'll run this GitHub action and observe that no migrations are executed against that database. And only then we'll go back here and improve this pipeline in order to start running those migrations. So to apply that migrations by building the bundle and running that bundle. So let me quickly commit the code and push it. On GitHub, we can see that we have our GitHub action running. So if we drill down into that execution, we can see our job. It performs the build and runs the deploy with success. But if we copy this endpoint, we go back into our project, get into our API requests file, let's try to get some movies. we can see that we have 500 an internal server error. So looks like something went wrong with this API. That means that we can access our server. And if we look into our database, the Postgres database, on the schemas, public, tables, we can't see anything there. So that means that the script was not executed. So let's bring that in place now by using that tool that we have been using, the .NET EF. Go back into the workflow, and there, once the build has been executed, so if you have a script specific for the release, this is a step that will be executed right before running the deploy. So if you have a pipeline specific for releases, this will be part of that pipeline. And then let's do the following. We'll run the command .NET tool install for the .NET EF. And then we will use that tool to run the migrations bundle. We have seen that before for that movies API. And we'll output it to the EF bundle file. Now that we have the EF bundle file, we can run that command. It's important also to provide the connection stream because we want to make sure that we are executing against the correct database. So I will get the connection string as a secret from my repo. Once we have that, let's commit the changes and push them. Go back into GitHub, go to the actions, and we can see a new action running. Drill down into it, and now let's see what will happen. Okay, build was executed. Now I'm running the install for .NET EF and I'm building the bundle. Bundle was created and now is running the migrations. And those migrations failed. And I knew that that was coming, but I wanted to show you something. I wanted to show you that the next steps will be skipped because that one failed. And that is one of the advantages of this approach. I don't have the risk of deploying something when the database is not capable of supporting that version. By having this in the pipeline, this will act as a condition for the next steps. And why is this failing? You can see it tried to perform the migrations by executing all the commands that are needed. But also you can see that I have an error because of the seeding feature. And there's something that is needed to do when you use the use seeding or the use seeding as a sync seeding is the fact that you need to have both there. So you can read in the exception that a synchronous store management operation was performed and no synchronous seed delegate has been provided. However, an asynchronous seed delegate was. That means that we are using the use async seeding but not the use seeding. And what it's saying is, please use an equivalent delegate. That is quite simple to do. Go back to the code, go to the program, and the same way that we are using the use async seeding, the bundle needs us to do the use seeding that is not asynchronous, so it doesn't have a cancellation token. That means that instead of using the wait here, I'm now doing the contains and I'm not awaiting the save changes anymore. I'm just calling the save changes. So same thing, you can see two implementations of exactly the same thing. Obviously we can improve this, extract some code, you know the drill. With this in place, let's commit and push it again. So add use seeding, run the push. And while the pipeline starts executing, let me show you something. If you go into the database, I'm using pgadmin for that, and we run a query against the EF migrations, we can see that the table is there, but no migration was executed. Why? Because the migrations failed, so there's no entry here. If we refresh the tables, we don't have any table there. So since it failed the migration, there's nothing happened. The database is exactly in the previous state. The only difference is that I have now here my EF migrations history, that is the table that is used to control the deployment to make sure that you don't run migrations twice. Go back into GitHub, check the actions that are running, get into that one, and let's see what happened now. So the run EF migrations was executed successfully, and we can see that it also ran the seed as well. and is now deploying the version of the web application. Why? Because the deployment of migrations was successful. So going back into our database, run the query to the fmigrations history, okay, there was two migrations there, the init and the add index on IA. And if we refresh the tables, now we have our movies table. And if we view all the data is there. That also means that now we can call the API and we get a response. So this is the process. In a moment that we need to bring new property into the model and we want to add a column to our database, the things that we need to do is the ones that you already know. You need to register a new migration. That migration will show up in this migrations folder. And based on that, now our pipeline is capable of detecting that we have a new migration and applying it before deploying the version of the code. One important thing that I want to show you is that if you want something that is not as opaque as the EF bundle, you have an option. So the same way that we have been running the .NET EF migrations bundle, let me collapse this here. So we are running that command. We could do something slightly different. We could run the .NET EF migrations script, and we can output a file with the SQL statements to perform the migration. So now we have this file that you can, for example, share with a DBA if you have a DBA in your company to review it and then get back and improve the model, for example. One thing that you will notice here is that we are starting a transaction and committing the transaction by the end. So something can happen here. For example, I run this migration once, I have the database, and I have created this table. So when I run this script again, it will fail. The table is already there. But there's one thing that you can do on that command. That is providing the argument idempotent. So with that, now you can see that the script has been built in a different way. Now is checking if the migrations were executed before running the migration itself. One of the things that you might have noticed already is that inside of this script, we don't have the seeding data. While the EF bundle is capable of doing that, the script doesn't have that. That means that you would need to have another way to do the seeding of the data, what is not a big deal, because in a production environment, it's quite rare to have something like that process of seeding the data as part of the startup of an application. It might be a given option that you have in the configuration of your application. It might be a script that you have prepared for that new version of your application, but it's not a big deal. It's not that common to see that happening. So this is a small difference when compared to the EF bundle approach. But in this approach, if you prefer to have the file, you can still apply the rest of the logic that you have been doing. So on your GitHub action, on your pipeline, you will have a step where you'll pick that file that you can generate and or a file that has been reviewed and is part of the repo. And you just need to connect to the database and run that script with the proper credentials for that. And one important thing for this strategy to work is that you always remember that your migrations should be retrocompatible. So at a given moment, you might be deploying the changes to a database and the version of the application that is running was designed for the previous version of the database. So if you add something like a column that is required and doesn't have a default value, you might have errors in production. So this often will mean that you will need to have several movements from a given version of the database to the desired final version of the database. So multiple steps, like adding a column that has a default value, and only eventually you might throw away that default value, only eventually you might make that column being required, because your goal is to do these deployments in two stages. First stage where you deploy the structure of the database and the second stage where you deploy the source code. So if you like this video, make sure that you go to my channel and you subscribe. I would love to see you there. Thanks, Nick. And as always, keep coding.